este muchacho que va a ver, va a preguntar si más puede estar, que algunos pueden trabajar con una organización que va a necesitar.
Tier 2 school like that. mean, you're a lane right now. Like, hey, man, sure. You can get a cup of coffee.
With 26% military affiliated student body population.
Mm-hmm.
Hi, Beverly Rebar with Chef. Yes, I just wanted to say hi. I talked to your aide about your bill, and I hope that she registered our comments.
Okay.
We're not really opposed. I wanted to make that point about the report.
Tell me what's going on.
Okay, sure. Yeah, I came to see your aide. Lauren, okay. Just to point out that we really have a serious cycle with all the institutions doing the public comments, so our point was just to see how it plays out, what the changes we do, because we do have a report that we're supposed to do by August 1st. We already know several colleges that it's only games two or three. So I
totally understand your position.
I think we've got like a history already.
Okay. Well, I understand.
Sure. It's not a problem.
Don't worry, you're doing your job.
Hi, Senator Chase. How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
Good. I drove by your office to try to set up a meeting. But I got to recircle back to set up something. Yeah. I don't know if anybody talked to you about anything. in state tuition this year. Yeah, so in-state tuition for immigrant community. I think people circled back last year. There was a lot of like a blow up and then.
Right. Yeah. I think we need to address immigration.
Yeah. I'm sure you've seen that it's like stuck. I think we're too close to DC to get that. Yeah, but I always think, I think it will, but at the same time, I think it's, and I highlighted this to Senator Norman, I think you have a constituency in the Latino community that thinks to be but it never gets any love from the Republican Party. So I always talk, once every month, yeah. And I always remain close. Remember that you have that constituency. Don't push it away by your vote.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. What about the licenses? You as well expressed that it made a lot of sense. They did a fiscal impact analysis that would actually bring in $10 to $17 million. So what are your thoughts on that as well?
I'm going to go back to my original.
Yeah. On the floor, that would actually I would ask you. I mean, I know that I can't. Okay, I would really appreciate it. I would appreciate. Obviously, we always. Yeah. I mean, we ran into the church. Maybe they banned here. What's the name of that church? The big cathedral that we live in. Catholic Church. That's where I saw you guys. Yeah. So I think it makes a lot of sense. I would support. I mean, we would obviously love for you to support. Realize that it's broken, and so I think that's the first start point when we accept that it's broken, and now we go from there. Yeah. Yeah. It makes a lot of sense. So, yeah, I would appreciate you speaking either in support of it or in support of it while maintaining neutral stance and the rest of it, not voting against it. Obviously, I will always ask for your support in any way possible. Sometimes they know a neutral vote by abstaining. Yeah, that will be important as well. I mean, we'll make our due diligence by making sure that we're talking to Senator Pogo, Senator Hanger. We want to ensure that all the legislators are voting in Senator Vista. All of the legislators have the information, even if it's a neutral. We want to ensure that folks feel reached out. We're not tied to a specific party because we also know the Democratic Party parties in power, they take communities for granted. And so I stress that I'm so I would truly appreciate what you're doing. Thank you, Sam. It's always good to chat with you.
I don't know. Yeah, okay.
Bueno, pero si el aire es buena.
I got a question.
Two questions.
Mine is,
litter boxes, where do they put those litter boxes? Sure, Senator Kagan. Bye, Senator. Bye, Senator.
Waiting, we appreciate it.
No.
objection, Senate Bill 146, Senator Stewart. Senate Bill 147, also Senator Stewart. Senate Bill 897, Senator DeStef. Senate Bill 898, Senator DeStef. Senate Bill 1068, Senator Kiggins. And SJR, no, those are the four that will be passed by for the day if there are no objections. Senate SJR 25, Senator Stanley requests that we carry over to 2021. And that would, okay. All those in favor carrying over SJR 25 to 2021, please say aye.
Aye.
No, I want to talk.
You want to talk?
No, I know, what am I saying? Aye.
Sam, you have something else?
Line jumper.
I've been sitting here for 20 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of committee I like right now. Everybody
Chairman's playing favorites.
That was 60 seconds. Madam Chair, members of the committee, Senate Bill 313 is a very short bill. As you know, I'm the chairman of the New College Institute Board of Directors. Currently, we have seven non-legislative citizen members on that board. What this bill seeks to do is just to amend that to increase the seven non-legislative members, citizen members, to 10. That those three would be representatives of businesses and industries throughout the Commonwealth, appointed by the governor. What we're seeking, as we know, NCI has been really moving in a direction where we're bringing industry in their area. We're providing educational opportunities that perhaps traditional institutions cannot offer, and certainly to those students who might not otherwise have the financial wherewithal to be able to afford a higher education. We're doing certification programs, credential programs, those kind of things. So what we're trying to do is get more outside involvement of companies and businesses throughout the Commonwealth to be interested in New College and the direction of our economy down there in Southside, Virginia. And that's the bill.
Are there those here in support of Senate Bill 313?
Madam Chair, our interim executive director, whom I think you may know and love as much as we do, Karen Jackson, is here speaking in favor of the bill.
Madam Chair, very quickly, as the Senator said, we are requesting this to provide additional input. Everybody's now talking about industry relevance and credentials and educational opportunities that can be directed to jobs. We need diversity from outside the region to get input, as well as being help getting ourselves into new and cutting edge industries such as esports, AR and VR, cybersecurity, and those are not skills that are nascent on the current board. So we'd like to have the opportunity to bring more in. Thank you.
Anyone here in opposition to 313?
You scared me.
Okay. Motion.
I move to recommend 49.
I'll be better.
Okay, I'll second.
Thank you.
Okay. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Thank you. It's always great to see you, Madam Chair.
Senator Chase.
This bill is actually a fond bill that Senator Peterson passed last year as it relates to public comment periods before boards actually go about raising their tuitions and their fees. This is to allow the students together with their parents to have input before the boards increase the fees and tuition. But that's already passed. It was Senator Peterson's bill, and I love the bill. What this bill does is it goes back and just tweaks it, because we had a couple colleges that had a public comment period, but they only, I know UVA gave a 3-day notice, which really isn't enough time, and I think William and Mary gave 5 days. Yes, and we can adopt. I'll explain this and then we'll adopt that. But what my bill does is it simply says that we need to give a 14-day notice so that parents and students can have time to prepare to come to Senator Peterson's public comment period, and then the amendment here, the substitute actually says also include the date, the time, and the location, just kind of common sense, but wasn't necessarily being done. So that's in essence the bill.
No, move the substitute.
Second. All in favor of adopting the substitute, please say aye.
Aye.
Madam Chair, question.
Senator, the language in your substitute basically says that the governing board shall also provide students and the public notice of the date, time, location of the meeting at which public comment will be permitted pursuant to subsection E. Does subsection E tell us how that notice is to be given?
Well, it refers back to the public period in line 47, shall permit public comment on the proposed increase at a meeting, as that term is defined in 2.2-3701 of the governing board. So it's the public comment period before they raise the tuition.
Madam Chair, my question was, what is the method of notice? I don't know what to
do. Okay, like you're saying, for instance, like, is it in the paper? Is it on a website? I will have to ask Stacy for that. Do you have a comment on that?
So about 2 years ago, the Senate General Assembly passed legislation requiring a 30-day notice prior to being tuition notified of a decision to raise tuition increases. So I believe what her bill would do would require also to include in that 30-day advance notice of a tuition vote for the notice of the public hearing to also be included in that same notification.
Could you clarify yourself?
His question is what method? Like, is it paper? Is it online?
Question specifically asks is what medium? Is it email? Is it website? Is it newspaper? Is it a sign tag on a telephone pole? What is it?
I don't believe it's specified, but I do know that most institutions do post on their website, and they also have other methods. I can speak for them, but.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, are there those here in support of Senate Bill 260?
Strongly support this bill. We think that students and parents should have ample time to meaningfully participate in preparing these notes. A lot of times these proposals are more complex, and we think they should have more than a few days to actually prepare for it. There's precedent in code for other public bodies that hold public hearings for decisions like this that don't traditionally hold regular public comment at all their meetings, including the Board of Education, the Virginia Baseball Stadium Authority, and local school boards when they're giving notice on charter school applications. So there is precedent in code for setting a time frame for public notice.
Anyone else? Those in opposition?
I would like to speak in favor of the bill.
Okay.
As a student that's done student organizing, and I've actually given the first public comment at George Mason Board of Visitors, I think this bill is very important for students to be aware of these meetings and public comment and their opportunity to speak for tuition increases or tuition freezes. So I support this legislation.
Thank you. Anyone else in support? Those in opposition?
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, members of the committee. My name is Beverly Rebar. I'm with the State Council of Higher Education. We're not so much opposed to the bill or think it'd be burdensome. We just think the law is so new that we haven't really been through a whole cycle of all the institutions complying with the law. SHEV is required to do a report yearly on the public comment process in August 1st, and our first report will be this coming August. So more in the nature of feeling it's a little premature to amend the law at this time. Thank you for your time.
Anyone else in opposition? Okay. We have the bill before us.
Madam Chairman, may I speak to the bill? All right. I like the idea of the bill. However, I don't like the nebulous requirements. I would be much more comfortable if there was a defined method of notice, but there isn't. It's basically there has to be notice. So again, they can just grab a couple of flyers, tap them on a telephone pole, and say, hey, we gave notice.
I'm happy to accept an amendment.
I'm here to amend your bill. Madam Chairman, I just for the sake of talking about it in committee, I'm going to make a motion to recommend reporting.
this is Chev just said that this is new, and they haven't had an opportunity to have a full year to actually review the legislation. That's what concerns me, that they haven't had an opportunity to actually review if this is working yet.
Even though we had two examples where it did not, that's okay.
I'm not gonna second the motion, so.
I have Peterson.
I think Peterson is supportive of the bill. I think he was a co-patron on the bill, and he seconded the bill.
And I'm not gonna second on his behalf.
All right. Thank you.
Orsco.
Madam Chairman, Chairwoman, today I have Senate Bill 935, and I have an amendment in the legislative substitute.
I move the substitute, Madam Chair.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye. We have a substitute before us.
Excellent. The amendment in the nature of the substitute was drafted with the assistance of the Commonwealth's higher education institutions with review by the Secretary of Education and the Office of Attorney General. The amendment establishes an exception to the domicile test in the existing code for determining eligibility for in-state tuition here in Virginia. This exception allows students who meet the criteria of this new code section to be eligible for in-state tuition regardless of their immigration status. This new code section provides in-state tuition for all students who attend a Virginia high school for at least 2 years and graduate from a Virginia private or public high school or program of home instruction or pass a high school equivalency exam that has been approved by the Secretary of Education. They must have graduated or passed the GED on or before July the 1st, 2008. Students, in case of a dependent of student, at least one parent, guardian, or person standing in loco parentis must submit evidence that they have filed Virginia income tax returns unless exempt by state law for at least 2 years prior to the date of the registration of enrollment. For those students who do not meet the requirements in the code section, the existing domicile test remains the law. Equitable access to education for all Virginians is something that we're hoping we can find this year. So that's what the substitute does.
Is there a fiscal impact to this?
There is no fiscal impact.
Not true. I'm just looking at LIS. We don't have a fiscal impact for the substitute. There is a fiscal impact statement for the original 335, and it says that there's no budget amount necessary.
Frank can answer that question.
Yes, ma'am. It's about the only question I can answer. Senator, we've spoken with Chev. They do not need any funds to administer this bill.
Those who are in support of Senate Bill
935. Good afternoon. Fran Bradford, Deputy Secretary of Education. The Governor and Secretary of Education strongly supports this bill. It is high time to make this important step. And I do want to say thank you to Senator Boysko and to all of those who have been working on this bill, many of them who are behind me on both sides of this room. There are smarter minds behind me who can answer the specific questions, but I just want to say how strongly the Governor supports it and how grateful I am for all the efforts we have to get to where we are.
Thank you.
Good.
Madam Chairman, members of the committee, Mark Smith, George Mason University, here in support of Senate Bill 935. I'd like to share with the Chairman, members, and staff a letter that President Holton has shared with all of you earlier in the session in support of this legislation. Out of respect to our students, I'd like to, if I might, yield my time to two or three students that came down from George Mason
resources like licenses and being able to apply to jobs is still at risk. The NSA tuition bill will help many undocumented students continue to pursue a path towards higher education like myself. This bill is crucial to many students who are finding themselves asking how they can afford to pay to college. Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, my name is Kristen Miranda, and I'm a student at George Mason University studying international politics and government. I'm here to speak in support of SB 935. I hope that you truly consider the significance of granting undocumented students NSA tuition rates, having met the prerequisites listed in the bill, and vote in support of it, not only because it's about to reduce the poverty rate, as it has in Maryland, increase institutional revenue for universities, and overall benefit the economy, but because each and every one of us has the inalienable right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. I'm asking for the liberty to compete with my colleagues on an equal playing field for our higher education and have a shot at living a better life than my parents did. Currently, I'm temporarily protected under DACA, and it is the only thing that makes attending college a possibility. The difference between paying in-state and out-of-state tuition determines whether or not I attend college. If I am forced to pay out-of-state tuitions, I have no choice but to drop out. SB 935 determines the trajectory of my entire life, and it would absolutely put me at a disadvantage. SB 935 were revoked. SB 935 is not asking for the special treatment of undocumented immigrants. It is simply asking lawmakers to give us the equal opportunity to compete for our higher education. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Jeanette. I am a student at USU. I just want to say that over the last 4 years of my life, my parents, my mom is a house cleaner, my dad is a landscaper. We have invested $42,000 out of pocket just for me to have my bachelor's in creative design. I'll be graduating this
That's
May.
A great field of study.
I'll be graduating this May, but I have a sister under DACA that still needs 2 more years in order for her to complete her accounting degree. So without this, if DACA is revoked, my sister nor will I will be able to continue. I won't be able to continue for a master's. I would never be able to maybe even one day work here, you know? So this is a really important, like, we're just everything. We need that, and hopefully everybody else can see how much support it has. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair and members of the committee. My name is Jorge Figueredo. I'm the executive director of a nonprofit organization that since 1998 has empowered immigrant and underserved youth and families through mentorship, education, leadership development, and parent engagement programs. During 2019, EduFuturo served 1,694 elementary, middle, high school students who attended Arlington and Fairfax County public schools, and also their parents. Every year, we serve 12 grade students in a year-round mentoring program, assisting these seniors with their college, financial aid, and scholarship application process. Our 2019 cohort of graduates received over $2.4 million in financial aid and scholarships for their first year of college. Over 70% of the students enrolling our youth programs will be the first generation in their family to go to college in the United States. Unfortunately, some of these students we serve, despite the fact that they will successfully graduate from high school in Virginia, are not able to pay in-state tuition due to their income levels or their immigration status. SB 935 will correct this matter. This legislation would not change the fact that citizens and residents of Virginia remain eligible for in-state rates. It will make college a viable option for those who could not otherwise afford it. SB 935 is an investment in Virginia's future. Educating non-citizens among us in the present means more educated new citizen population when the possibility of naturalization is realized. Odds of educational and economic success improve for the American-born citizen offspring of immigrants when their parents are more highly educated. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, members of the subcommittee, Jared Calfee with Virginia 21. We support this legislation. We believe that people who are living in Virginia and learning in Virginia are Virginians. I'd add that we conduct an annual survey of young people in Virginia, primarily current Virginia college students. We've asked this question for the last several years regarding this policy, and over 75% of our respondents have responded in support of it, and so we hope you'll vote for it.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Elizabeth Griffin. I'm here for the Office of the Attorney General. The Attorney General strongly supports this bill. We has supported similar bills in prior years since he entered office in 2014. My main role in this process has been to help address some of the legal implications with this bill, so if you have questions in that regard, I'm happy to address them.
Thank you. Anyone else? That's not that all of you are standing or in support. Okay, anyone here in opposition?
Madam Chairwoman, I am so pleased to have this group of people here with us today. This is a life-changing opportunity that we have in front of us. Currently, many students are able, because the Attorney General has worked to help meet them, but this would codify that, and it's the right thing to do, and I'm so pleased that my colleague, Dr. Hamshi, is my partner in this.
Questions? So we have Senate Bill 935 before us. Need motion?
I move to report.
I'll second.
Madam Chair, before we take the vote, can I ask a question?
Sure.
I live in a highly military area, so let me ask you a question. If a senior chief petty officer has his home of record in Florida and is stationed in Norfolk, can his children get in situation in Virginia?
So, Madam Chairman, according to the other exceptions for who can come, any active duty member, active guard, or reserve member, mobilized or temporarily active orders for 180 days or more who resides in the Commonwealth, any veteran who resides in the Commonwealth, any surviving spouse who resides in the Commonwealth following the completion of active duty, and a non-Virginia student who establishes domicile before being called to active duty to the National Guard, and maintains at least one of the following Commonwealth: a driver's license, a motor vehicle, a voter registration, employment, a property ownership, or a source of financial support.
So, Madam Chair, the answer to my question would be no. The senior chief's children would not be able to receive in-state tuition in his home residence in Florida, or Texas, or North Carolina, or his house. So that's any unequal access problem that I have. So I just want to make a point.
Okay, the motion is to recommend reporting. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. And Peterson is an aye.
Chaitin Adelford, no.
Okay.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you.
Senator
Reeves.
I'm
sorry.
It's not
Jesus. Well, we look so much alike.
Madam Chair, I'm going to discuss today Senate Bill 897. If we could take Senate Bill. The one I wanted to go back to is 895. I apologize. I may have had my statement on the wrong bill. And then we're going to carry over 897 is a very simple bill that is shed in higher education.
So we have a
I have my statement on the wrong bill.
Back for the day, without objection, 895. We're going to take up 897.
Yes, ma'am. And we have a substitute, so we're going to pass out that substitute. The substitute was worked out with Shev and the Higher Education Council and a few other folks. And everybody's very happy with it. Very simple bill, and what it does, Madam Chair, members of the committee.
That's not a substitute.
Second.
Move the second that we adopt the substitute to Senate Bill 897. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
Shev will develop education materials for board members who sit on university boards to be updated every 2 years of service. And what this will do is it'll anything we do here, it'll keep them abreast of what we're doing. It's just a great continuing education process. Shev supports it. Higher education supports it, and I haven't had anybody against it yet, but it's still early. Thank you, and that's pretty much all it does. It says we'll, every 2 years, we'll give you an update on the information that's new and refresh your course and the duties, responsibilities, and what laws have changed.
Senator Bistef, how are they going to get this training? Are they going to have to go to physical training or in-person training, online training?
Madam Chair, Senator Cosgrove, this is online training, and they have to go through regular training anyway, which covers their all of the EEOC type things, so this would be an addition to that.
Any other questions? Those in support?
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, members of the committee. I'm Beverly B. Barbashev. We do appreciate the opportunity to work with the Senator on this bill, and we ask that you support it.
Anyone here in opposition? Moved and seconded that Senate Bill 897 be reported. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Madam Chair, members of the committee, thank you very much. I hope next week when I come back with Senate Bill 895 to have the exact same concurrence with everybody.
That's really good. You can live in hope. Because I thought it was to take by, but you wanted to carry it.
895, we wanted to take by for the day. 898, we wanted to
carry over. Okay, so Senate Bill 898, we want to carry over to 2021. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Madam Chair, thank you.
Now, Senator Reeves.
What? Madam Chair, I have Senate Bill 462. And I think it might address Senator Cosgrove's issue as well. This came to me from a retired military family after 27 years who, when they went on active duty, Virginia was their home record. So their whole time, 27 years, they paid Virginia taxes, they did all that stuff, but they never wound up at his last duty station making it back to Virginia. So their kids got into, one of their kids got into UVA 2013-16. Double major, all that stuff. They've got a few more. And right now they're facing an onslaught of tuition. One is looking at going to UVA and it's over $50,000 a year. Now for engineering, it's over $71,000 a year. This is a Virginia resident, same what Senator Cosgrove was talking about, but their kids can't get a state tuition. So what my bill does is, if you look on line 41, it's a two-line thing, and we put a caveat into this thing that said any child of an active duty member or veteran who claimed Virginia as his home state or home record if you're military and filed Virginia tax returns for at least 10 years during their active duty status, their children wouldn't have any state tuition. So I think this is one remedy, and it does put a burden on them as far as showing the tax returns, but I think it's the direction of what I'm hearing now and where we're going with this thing. I think it's only fair that we take care of those families that have made Virginia their home. They started here, they want to retire here, and with the veterans population we have now, a lot of folks are leaving to go to Texas, Tennessee, and Florida, and we're trying to keep those vets in. So I think this is more than fair to kind of help resolve that issue.
So the situation that you just described, did the person return to Virginia?
They started their career. Let's say they went to college, got commissioned. They go to Fort Benning's, their first duty station. They have Virginia tags on their license plate, or in John's case, maybe the West Coast,
Pensacola.
So they're in Florida for that duty station. They're paying all their Virginia taxes, everything they have, all their payroll, all that stuff. Then they get transferred to Texas. Now, they have the opportunity to become a resident of Texas, but they stay as Virginia residents that whole time. And so as they've done that and paid their taxes, they're not getting anything for it. They're just proud Virginians who supported us. And so that always stays with you. Like my home record was Houston, Texas. When I finally exited the military in Colorado, the military would pay for me to go home to Houston, and that distance is as far as I go, whatever your original home record. And I've always paid up until I got off active duty. Everything that I had in Texas belonged to Texas. So this is a way for these families. The closest they got stationed back to Virginia was at the War College in Carlisle, PA. They never made it back to the Pentagon, right? But they've always been a Virginian and paying their taxes. But they don't have any state because they don't actually live domiciled in the state. Does that make sense? Because they're on active duty. Mm-hmm. They're stationed all over the world. they pay all their Virginia taxes, they keep their tags on their cars the same, they pay the registration. They just don't live in Virginia, but they're Virginians.
Okay.
Madam Chair, I have two questions.
Okay.
First off, who would ever go to UVA for an engineering degree?
Anyone.
Really?
My
I have one at UVA right
my
now.
Daughter.
I have one that graduates in May, but not
all right, serious question.
I strenuously protest.
This actually does not meet the example I gave earlier.
Close, but the tax part, I know.
Yeah, I'm supportive of the bill, but it still doesn't meet, you know, what I was talking about. But an active duty member of his family is here while he's stationed and deployed, you know, is still not getting, you know, instant.
Well,
I mean, it has nothing to do with the bill. I get my own bill. I'm just saying.
No. I'm not adverse to admitting it to even make it better. We were trying to figure out a way that you could show proof of that residency through the taxation part and everything else. Because
I understand. You need to stop talking about how to support your bill.
No, but if we can make it better, now's the time.
No, later.
Okay. That's the bill, Madam Chair.
All right. Got any witnesses?
Just me.
Say
it's 5 something. It's almost 6 o'clock. My witnesses. You know. I do not believe that our institutions.
Anyone here in opposition? Okay. Okay, we have Senate Bill 462. Does it have to go in? You just recommend it to the full committee. They'll decide if they want to send you to finance.
I didn't get a sheet on it. That doesn't mean it won't find its way there.
Okay.
We would recommend report.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that Senate Bill 462 be reported. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Mr. Chair, probably if I meant that, if we want to take a note, should I do a little bit?
Yeah, both of them.
Thank you all.
Okay, so both of Marston. They requested that those bills go back for the day, so that means that we are done. She asked that hers go back.
Okay.
So,
I'll go listen.